Okay, thank you everyone. Thank you for inviting us. So my name is Uju Ugochukwu. I'm a consultant psychiatrist and medical director for quality and also a quality improvement coach. So I'm here with my colleague, Helen, and I'll allow you, Helen, to introduce yourself.
Yeah, hi everyone. Yeah, we're really pleased to be here today. I'm Helen Smith. I'm a mental health nurse of many years in my background, but I'm also a quality improvement coach and supporting Uju and everybody else within our AMI project.
Yeah, thank you, Helen. Next slide, please. So just to give you a little bit of a background of our trust, so we are a big mental health trust covering the whole of Norfolk and Suffolk, population of about 1.6 million, and we have a range of services, both well-being and a range of secondary mental health services, and staff population of about 4,000, so quite a huge trust. So next slide, please. So we're going to talk to you about our journey so far in deciding on our first population. And one of the first things we did when we joined the collaborative, and by the way, we are quite excited to join this collaborative, and just reflecting the last 18 months, 2 years, about how COVID-19 has really highlighted the inequalities in health. So when we heard about this collaborative, it was exciting to be a part of it. One of the first things that we did, and this was back in August, was to publicize that we're doing this piece of work, both internally and in external organizations as well, and get a lot of interest around the work that we were doing. So next slide, please. So the next step for us then was thinking about who would be in our overarching project group. So thinking about the overarching project group before we then start thinking about the subgroups. And as you can see from that list, we had quite a range of people with different expertise. A lot of them were people who had some knowledge, experience, skills in the area of inequalities. And usefully, a lot of them were also from different backgrounds, different ethnicities. So they brought different things to the table. And we had our senior participation lead who helped us in identifying service users and experts by experience who joined the overarching project group. And of course, our quality improvement coach, Emily, who has been excellent. Okay, next slide, please. Thank you. So we had our first meeting back in September, and it was really a brainstorming exercise. So really just thinking through, so which populations do we need to focus on? And we used the Jamboard for people to just put in which populations that they felt were being underserved. And people just walked silently, putting in everything that they wanted to add. And we used 4 questions to guide us. So thinking about where is there will and urgency, where do we already have some data? Is there any work happening in those specific areas? And also thinking about any relationships with existing stakeholders that we had already. And you can, as you can see, we end up with a very busy slide. And I was thinking to myself, oh my God, how are we going to decide on which population to start with? So we're able to group some of them. And we ended up with about 16, I think it was 16 to start with. Next slide, please, Emily. We ended up with about 16 populations, which is still quite a huge number. And yeah, we're in a panic about how we're going to do this work and decide on our eventual population. Next slide. So what we did, we had a 2-week period when people could go back in and just keep adding information. Whatever information they wanted to add on any of the populations we'd identified, any additional work that they knew that was happening that they needed to add in. And at our second meeting, we had lots of structured conversations around each of those populations and talked about populations that were potentially overlapping. We discussed intersectionality between the different groups. We talked about some data that would help us in identifying which population to work with. But I think having those structured conversations helped us in narrowing down a little bit. So in the end, I think we came up with, I think it was about 6 or 7 groups that we're going to focus on just to help us narrow it down a little bit. And then subsequently, move on to the next slide. So this is just to give you an idea of what our Jamboard looked like. So if you remember, we had that very busy Jamboard that had everything. But also, I think what it did for us was highlight that this wasn't just about the priority population to work with, and it was more about which population could we start with. And that word priority wasn't really helpful because there was obvious inequalities across the board in various domains. But we needed to have a way of just deciding on which population to start with. And seeing this collaborative, I see it more like a foundation to the work that we need to continue doing beyond the 3-year period, that we can then continue to pick up on other populations as we go along. So this is just to give you an idea of the 4 questions and also the Jamboard that we used. So I'll hand over to Helen, who will then talk us through how we then got on to decide on the final population and some of the data that we used to help us with that decision. So I'll hand over to you, Helen.
Yeah, thanks, Uju. Could you move on to the next slide, Emily? Yeah, so the next session we used a fantastic session, actually, which was very well supported by Emily, where we'd, as Uju described, we had narrowed down our groups where we felt we wanted to start our work. And we went through a really sort of structured process by which we all had an opportunity to vote for the populations that we felt perhaps we wanted to start with first. And so what this is showing you is where people placed their votes on the left-hand side. We've got the populations that we were looking at, and you can see that in terms of, we then went on to rank order those, and at the top, the most people ranked this first group at the top. But the key thing was it wasn't about, so the one which was voted for most would be the group that we'd started with, because actually where the richness came was the discussion in things like, well, why did LGBTQ plus not have quite so many votes, and we had a really rich conversation about that. And I think what it led us to reflect on was that actually, depending on who you have in your overarching group and the knowledge base that they have, the particular experience they have, that perhaps we needed to start to have a bit more look at the data that was accessible, to see whether that helped us to make a more informed decision about where we might start. So we decided that given that the top group here of Black, Asian and minority ethnic groups, we decided to see what data we could get internally from our own trust. Next slide. Thank you. So the first thing that we had a look at was to see where our referrals came in from by source. And as you can see there, their referrals in their thousands, and by far our biggest referrer were GPs in general practice, followed by police, followed by self-referrals, and then accident and emergency. And so it's important to say that one individual could have more than one referral, but we're dealing with really sort of quite big numbers here. So that was our first step, and that was all genders, all ethnicities, that was everyone. Next slide, please, Emily. And then this was, we started to break down some of those sources so that we looked at the three biggest sources of referrals, and we compared. And this is where we started to break down into male and female and also ethnicity. And what you can clearly see on this slide was that we were very much drawn to Black men. And you can see here that Black men, in terms of their referrals into mental health services, showed that by far the biggest source of referral was through the police. And a really low referral rate through from our GPs, who are responsible for most of our referrals for all populations. And clearly that got us thinking, I think we were kind of all aware that nationally, we're aware that there is an issue around Black men their access to mental health services and how often they're overrepresented within the criminal justice system. And so that was a real eye-opener for us all. Next slide, please. And then We thought we'd also have a look at black men admitted to one of our, we've got 26 wards in our trust. And although the numbers were low, actually what you can see is on this chart, the orange line is what our census, the 2011 census, tells us is our general population of black men within Norfolk and Suffolk. And you can see that the blue line and the data points show that actually black men are overrepresented in terms of admissions to mental health hospitals or to our mental health wards. Next slide, please. And then we did also have one other piece of research that was carried out, which was around restrictive interventions in, and in particular prone restraint. So for those of you that don't work in mental health units, there are times where we are needing to restrain patients, sometimes giving them medication, and prone restraint is where a patient is restrained on their front. And this is something that we always try to avoid, both primarily for safety and safety reasons, as well as the sort of trauma of that. And although that we found that ethnic minorities as a whole were 30% less likely to have had prone restraint, we actually found that Black African people, both men and women, were 7 times more likely to have prone restraint compared to white British people. And that was just all, that was, it's important to say this was a really small sample, but the appropriate research methods were taken to show that that was a significant difference. And so that was kind of really telling for us in terms of confirming that actually we wanted to choose black men as our first population. And I'm now going to hand back over to Uju, I believe.
Yes, thank you, Helen. Yes, so with all that information, it was easy for us to make that decision to focus on black men. And if you look back on the first slide that Helen shared, I think men, we had men was one of our priority or one of our populations, but they were, I think it was the number 4 or so. And as Helen said, it wasn't really about where they were on that list. It was more about having that conversation. And once we saw the data, it was easy for us to make that decision. Actually, this was really a group that was marginalized and it was a group to focus on. So next slide, please. So what we're doing now is what is called a 3-part data review, so to help us explore the needs and assets of Black men. We're doing some of that already in terms of just gathering available data. A lot of it is from our informatics team. We're linked up with primary care, so we have like a number of CCG leads, GP leads, who have joined us, but unfortunately they haven't got any data to share. And we've also tried to link in with other organizations to find out where there was some data available. So far, the data we've got is around what's happening in our trust. But also we're trying to dive deeply into the data we've got already to see, okay, we have all these people being referred to us by the police force. How many of them are being accepted by services? What are they being treated for? What are their outcomes? So we'll be doing a lot of that to help us understand what's happening with Black men. And then the second part is engaging with care teams and professionals who have been providing care to this group. Fortunately for us, we had a mental health well-being team a few years ago that was focused around mental well-being of men, not particularly black men, but men in general. But the lead for that team, the team no longer exists, but the lead still has very good contacts that he's given us and will be exploring those contacts. We've got a chaplain who also has links to community groups, to Black churches, and we'll be doing a lot of that work in the next few weeks just to make sure that we can begin to understand the assets and needs of the Black men in our community. And then the other thing that we're doing is linking in with our BME network. So we're meeting with them next week, actually, and the BME networks in other organizations. The one that stands out for us is the police force. So ideally, we'd want somebody in our sub project group to be from the police force. but just to help us to understand when we meet with the BME network next week, to help us to understand what's going on, to tell them a little bit about our project. And we're hoping to recruit some people from the network to join our project group. Okay, next slide. And I suppose the probably the most important part of everything that we're doing is then hearing from Black men, from the Black community. And we're going to do that in various ways. We've mentioned the three obvious ways to do this, that kind of recognizing that people, we have to engage with people in various styles to be able to get the information that we need. So carrying out a general survey, but very much hoping that the survey will be co-designed. So we'll be working very hard to make sure that we get the right people to help us in designing the questions that we're going to ask, but also conducting focus group. And for some people, it will be one-to-one interviews. So this is what we're thinking. But to underpin all this, we'll be setting up our sub-project group that will help us in doing this work. So next slide, please. And then whilst focusing on our first population, we also have to be thinking about how we identify our second and third population. And just going back to those questions that helped us in the beginning and using that to think about the other populations that we may want to focus on. So I won't go through this in detail, but just quickly, I'll mention two populations. So the refugees and asylum seekers. So we have some work that's happening already in this area. We have some outreach teams. We have a psychiatrist who is doing a monthly clinic for refugees in our area. So we'll be engaging with them to find out a bit more about the population and then think, is it a population that we need to be working with? And the other group is people with ASD and people with ADHD. This may be a population that we may consider for our third population. There's a lot of work that we need to do in terms of understanding what the difficulties and the challenges are around them. Similarly with the LGBTQ+. But these are some of the groups that we'll be thinking about. So we'll be working towards identifying hopefully our second population as soon as possible. And next slide. So this is really to summarize everything that we've said so far and what our next steps are. So we've identified our first population, thankfully. And then the focus now would be on choosing our second and third populations. Hopefully we'll get our second population by Christmas, but we need to do a lot of work around identifying that second population. And if anything, what the first population has taught us is the importance of data, engaging with the community, but also getting some data to back up whatever information that we decide to do. And then working on really establishing our sub-project group. So right now, I think we have three people who have agreed to join the group. So we'll be working to make sure we have the right people in that group, to make sure we have a number of people who have lived experience or carers and family members that can join us, because they are the best people to help us in doing that piece of work and exploring the needs and assets of the population. And then finally, we'll be building on our communications. So we've already had a number in the past, but actually going forward, we need to keep those communications going both internally and externally, because that's how we generate the interest. That's how we make sure that people know about what we're doing and have a way of linking in with the work that we are doing. So next slide. And that is it actually. So happy to take any questions.
Wow, thank you so much, Uju and Helen. That was amazing. I'm so impressed by the work that you've done. And I just wanted to pick up on a couple of things about it first myself. So the first is, I just thought, so someone made a comment in the chat that seeing your Jamboard really made them feel better about their own Jamboard. And I think that was a compliment, not a criticism. But I think the point is, it kind of looked quite messy and unstructured. And I think you said, Uju, you thought, my God, how are we going to narrow this down now? But I think that's the point of this work. It's really iterative, and it starts off with very broad thinking that you then kind of narrow down. But what I also really liked was your description of how you use the multivote and ranking process. So you talked about that, it gave you a rank order, but it didn't then give you a rank order that you just sort of blindly followed. So that you used it, and I think with something like this has to be used in this way as a way to sort of ask questions to yourself about it and why. So why do we rank it like that, and trying to get into the richness of the discussion. So that's brilliant to hear. And then sort of triangulating that with the data review, and then obviously the sort of talking to the population work that you started and that it's continuing. I think it's just a brilliant demonstration of exactly how to do this sort of work so far. So thank you so much for that. I'm really pleased that you're able to do that. There are some questions of detail in the chat, and I wondered if you might be able to go into the chat after this and answer them in the chat, because I'm just conscious of time. There were a couple of things people were asking about. We're going to share the slides and the presentation. So yes, they'll be shared and on the website, so you can see those and everyone will be able to see those, and I hope they do look at them because they're so useful. There was just one question that I wanted to ask you to answer here before we move on to the next item, which was about, it was from Faith, and she's asked, how will the survey be disseminated and to who? Who will be invited to interviews and focus groups, and how will you go about that recruitment? So I think what the question is probably getting at is, so how do you get to the right people to talk to about this stuff in your population? I'd be interested to hear your thoughts about that.
Yeah, that's a very good question. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, so we're going to be approaching it through various ways. I think I mentioned previously that luckily we had some work that was already done in the past with men well-being generally. So we've already formed some links with that lead, and also links with some chaplains who has links with community groups. So that would be our first task, would be to discuss with them, find out where the community groups are, and then think about how we do it with those groups. And also I mentioned the DME network that will be joining. So we're hoping to have some people that will join us from there to think through about what we're going to be doing, and also people with lived experience from our trust that can help us think it through as well. So those will be our first areas. And I suppose it's easier in Norfolk because we've got some of the links then, but we also have some links in Suffolk which we'll be exploring as well. So I think it's very much what we've done before. Start somewhere, see where we get to, keep asking those questions, keep thinking about, are we missing anything? Is there anything else that we need to know? And hopefully we'll get to the right answers around that.
Yeah, I was just going to add to that, Uju, that we're very lucky that we're supported by our small research department within NSFT, and they have a huge amount of experience in how to reach the right populations with an initial survey. So we'll probably use social media using our current NSFT Twitter account and things like that. But we very much know that we're going to have to reach out further than that into these different community areas, and so we've got a plan around that, but we're really going to have to pull on the experience and knowledge of those who live within those communities, but also using the expertise that we have internally about getting feedback and input from others.
Yeah, that's brilliant, thank you. So I think as Uju sums up, it's start somewhere, keep talking to people, asking questions, ask yourself questions about who you might be missing, and build on the links and the resources that you have, which is kind of great advice, I think. I'm gonna